the HouseDog.com Real Estate Show. I'm your host, Bryan Crabtree. Coming up today, foreclosures have doubled since 2021 and then some, but is that a misleading headline? Plus, when will rates, interest rates on mortgages dip below 6% and the commissions cut in half? Many are saying that headline is absolutely misleading, but the $418 million settlement by the National Association of Realtors is not misleading, and it has significant impacts on real estate agents and home sellers and buyers. Will outline all the up-to-date details that we're learning, plus home price predictions for 2024. HouseDog.com for your real estate needs in the Charleston Tri-County area. But in the meantime, let's dive into the numbers. Let's start with this big bombshell that was dropped last Friday from the National Association of Realtors, which basically has said that we're going to cut commissions in half. I put this on Facebook. I did an initial broadcast, and I got some flack pretty big time. Here's someone who is a pretty prominent real estate broker in East Tennessee. He says, my comments about cutting commissions in half are misleading. Commissions are not cut in half. NAR, the National Association of Realtors, he says, doesn't control our commission, and they are and always have been negotiable. Now the seller will simply negotiate their fee with the listing agent, and the buyer will negotiate their fee with the buyer's agents. More transparency, saying this to me, I guess, don't mislead for clickbait, right? There's nothing misleading about saying the fact that these real estate commissions have been cut in half. It has absolutely, by the fact of this settlement and the fact that the National Association of Realtors, like them or not, and I don't, I'm not a realtor, I'm a real estate agent and broker. There's a small distinction there. I'm just not part of the trade organization. Doesn't mean I'm not out there in the public working with people. But the bottom line here isn't that. It's that when they say we're no longer going to offer commissions in the MLS, what they're basically saying is we're going to take away the vehicle for a home seller to call a real estate agent and list their home for 5 or 6%, the rough traditional averages. There's always been negotiable fees. Everyone's negotiated. But I'll tell you what, as I've been in this business 25 years, when I have put out marketing at various different times that have a negotiated commission possibility in it, I get a lot of flack from the real estate community. Our fees should be held at 6%, right? Or 7% or 5%. I mean, there seems to be this unspoken narrative in the industry, this is why there's a lawsuit about it, that fees should be fixed, like we shouldn't cut our fees. And that's basically what's being said here, is that home sellers should be able to sit down with a real estate agent and negotiate their fee. And to say that that has been the case is true, but there has been this, I guess, unspoken effort. The lawyers called it a conspiracy to basically fix the fees. Now, we can get into the mincing of words there, but what NAR has said is that we'll no longer offer a buyer agent commission when they go to bring that buyer to that home. So that completely changes the negotiation of a listing contract between a home seller and a real estate agent. It just changes it, which means that now the fees essentially been cut in half. That doesn't mean that some real estate agents can't say, I'm still going to charge you 6% and I'm going to reserve this other 3% in order to be able to pay and incentivize a buyer's agent to bring their buyer to this house. But what this has done is opened up sort of the floodgates for home sellers to be able to basically say, listen, I'm just going to pay you a fee, and then we'll let the buyer and the buyer's agent bring an offer and negotiate. I actually think this is great. I've always thought that being a buyer's agent, while it is a valuable tool and resource for the quality buyer's agents there that serve buyers, I've always thought that it's a lot more work and it takes a lot more skill to list a house and to market it to the public using Facebook, social media of all kinds, YouTube, videos, professional photography, flyers, direct mail, data, mining and sending it to target audiences that might be likely to buy that house. It's always been, to me, more of a skill set that deserves a higher fee for those that list and sell houses correctly. buyer's agents, by and large, a valuable service. I don't take that away to the buyer community, but a lot of buyer's agents are the starters in our community. Most of the top real estate agents work with sellers predominantly and then work with their own clients as buyers. This is going to fundamentally change all these big teams in the real estate business. It's going to improve, I think, the quality of the process, because now in order for the buyer to be represented, they're going to have to choose an agent, not because, oh yeah, we represent you for free, but because this buyer's agent is going to provide a valuable service. So commissions have been cut in half at the listing table with a homeowner. It may not be the case right now, because this doesn't really kick in the multiple listing services until two things happen. July is when they said they would kick it in, and when this is approved by the judge. So there is a chance, very unlikely, but a chance that the judge in these cases doesn't approve this. But more than likely, this goes through, and come July, there will not be any more offers to cooperate with buyer's agents. This just simply means the seller can sit down and be more negotiable and kind of what I've been doing for 20 years, negotiate a fee of services. Listen, if you just want me to help you represent you and negotiate for you and protect you, there's a fee for that. And that'll be smaller than if you want me to come in and take everything and do it for you. You just want white glove service. That's a different fee. And in terms of producing a buyer, I don't believe that buyer's agents necessarily bring buyers to properties. I believe good listing agents, like myself and others, market properties effectively and then bring those buyers to the property. And then they just happen to be working with a buyer's agent who shows up and wants 3% commission. I know that that's a very unpopular comment to make in a room full of real estate agents. They just simply don't like it. Chuck on my Facebook post puts out of curiosity then, because commissions have always been negotiable, does that mean that the seller negotiates a total fee they will accept to pay and a buyer pays their own fee? I'm confused. So there is a lot of confusion on this in the marketplace. Here's what I think is going to happen. I could be wrong here, but I'm going to start doing this way now. So if you're looking to sell, I'm just going to talk about what I think is going to happen. I'm going to go ahead and get ahead of the trend. And if you're looking to sell your home, here's what I'm going to present. I'm going to offer you either a 2% list fee or a 3% list fee. And I won't bore you with the details of the differences here. That's the total commission you will pay as a home seller with me going forward. 2% or 3%. That's it. Now, if we put that in the multiple listing service, my goal is to do all the marketing with Facebook, data analytics, to make sure that every buyer that's out there shopping right now, whether they're on Zillow, Trulia, Realtor.com, Homes.com, that's 90% of all home traffic, by the way. And then if we miss them there, because those sites manipulate everything, then we do social media marketing through Instagram, TikTok, Facebook, other things on Google AdWords, and then remarketing and retargeting. All this is expensive. So depending on what tier and level of this you want, you'll pay 2 or 3%, and then we'll give you the best representation possible in dealing with that buyer or buyers that come along. Multiple offers is the goal. They will probably have in tow a real estate agent who hasn't caught up yet or who refuses to accept the reality that commissions have actually been cut in half. Okay, this isn't for clickbait. This is going to happen. And most of this industry is going to resist it. They're going to talk down people like me who just go, let's just go past all the BS and say, this is what's going to happen. So they're going to all the negative comments I get on social media about anything I say, because I'm saying something that's uncomfortable, but true. So the seller lists, buyer shows up with the agent. There's five offers. Okay. If I've done my job, there's five offers. There's not much inventory. So five offers show up, and one of them is a buyer unrepresented. They're my customer. They offer the same amount as everyone else, but everyone else is behind asking the seller to pay for the commission. Who wins? The customer. I don't get any more commission out of this necessarily. Because I'm not representing these people. I'm just helping them. And I might charge them a fee to write the contract. That's between me and the buyer. But the seller's not going to pay me any more money. They've paid me to do my job and produce buyers and bring them to the property. I don't want to represent the buyer and the seller at the same time anyway. So I'm going to have them be a customer, might charge them a couple of $1,000s to write the contract up, and then they win. Now, all these buyer's agents over here who think that the seller's still going to pay their commission are going to lose. Their buyers are going to lose. Or let's say my buyer that's my customer makes an offer, but someone else makes an offer for $1,500 more, but that buyer says to their buyer's agent, I want this house. This is the one I want. I'll pay you your fee. They negotiate that separately. Home still sells for top dollar, sells for the same amount of money. I don't believe that this is going to change the value of homes. I've heard that put out there. It's not going to drive prices down. We don't have any inventory. Prices are going up. So there's a lot of people who are going to try to say, this was good for realtors. This was good for the community. It really is good for the community, but there's a different component of this that realtors aren't going to acknowledge here. They're joining the National Association of Realtors for them to be represented and protected, not the consumers, but the realtors, and they just sold them up the river. Good for me, good for you as a home seller, but not necessarily good for the industry at large. So let's go to the third comment, and then we'll move on to the other topics like what appreciation we're going to expect in 2024. When will interest rates be below 6%? That coming up here on the HouseDog.com real estate show. Rachel, who is a real estate agent in Charleston, posted on my Facebook feed, need more fact checking. I'm not sure if that's pointed at me or not, but I have my facts straight. More details come out daily. I agree with her there. This is going to take shape, and we're going to keep covering this. Commissions were always negotiable. That is by fact true. Commissions were always negotiable. But there was a very serious downside to not offering at least 2.5% in the multiple listing service. That's why, even though they settled and admitted no fault, the realtors lost here. I say the realtors because I'm not a realtor. I'm just a real estate broker. I'm not part of the trade organization. The realtors lost because they cheated. That's what they did. New buyers are educated by seasoned agents and realtors so they know their commission structure rights. Those who mislead get caught deservingly. I'm not sure what she's meaning by that, but she's right. I mean, I know she's a prominent agent in the Charleston area, does good business as far as I know, so I'll take her on face value. Is it true that less agents will continue on in the industry? I mean, she goes on, clients make a smart move. They split details regarding compensation. In my opinion, I love being a realtor. I get to help advise others as to making wise investments, and we all know former financial advisor writing this, that a real estate transaction is the best investment one can make. If there's ROI for the client, there's plenty of commission to be made. Now, I don't disagree with any of that in principle, but I think there's a misnomer about all of this. You can love being a real estate broker who helps your clients buy and sell real estate, who advises. I'm also a mortgage loan officer, so I love doing all of it. I love helping put complex situations together in a positive way for people as much as Rachel does. I just don't see the need to be a realtor to do it. There's a lot of pressure on us to be realtors. If you don't join the realtors organization, we'll make you pay non-member dues to have multiple listing service access. That, by definition, is antitrust. So I hate being a realtor. If I have to be a realtor, I'd be a realtor. But a lot of times, you don't have to be a realtor. You just pay a fee. You waste money in order to have access to the multiple listing service. That, by definition, is antitrust, and I think that's one of the problems in the real estate business. You can love being a client advisor, love serving your clients, and all of that's going to get better because of this settlement, but it's not going to help people who are average or below average continue to be in this business. That's the win here. The realtors just, I mean, by trying to save their power, they got rid of a lot of the weakest people in the industry. It's not going to happen overnight, but it's going to happen. So that's my two cents on where we are with this. You want to list a house, negotiate. Now, I had a call this weekend from a friend of mine in Tennessee who said, well, I tried to list my house in Tennessee, and they wanted 6%, and they would negotiate 3%, like you said. Well, my view is that if you can't sit down with an agent and you're thinking about selling your house, wherever in the country you are watching this, Charleston or beyond, call me if you're in the Charleston coastal South Carolina area from Beaufort up to Myrtle Beach. I'm based in Charleston. And I'll have an intelligent conversation with you about how to strategize this. But if you can't have that conversation with someone, you're in Timbuktu, Michigan, find someone you can, because you need someone who's going to know in the time from when you prepare and list your house how this is going to impact everything. So let's go back to data. I'm going to run through kind of a rapid fire here of what's happening. There's another misleading headline. Foreclosures are more than double since 2021. So here's kind of what's being said. Adam, a leading curator of land, property, and real estate data, released its year-end 2023 U.S. foreclosure market report, which shows foreclosure filings, default notice, scheduled auctions, and bank repossessions were reported on 357,000 and some change properties across the United States in 2023. That's up 10% from 2022, but that's up 136% from 2021. Now, if you read this data, stopping right there at the from 2021, this would indicate that foreclosure activity is up by, what, two and a half times, close to two and a half times since 2021. But here's the key number, and this is where I don't mislead and I don't do clickbait. That's down 28% since 2019. So foreclosure activity in comparison, this normal market here, only thing abnormal about this market is we don't have good interest rates compared to what we had in 2019, but they're not bad. They're just higher. But this is a normal market, 2024. It's kind of unexciting. It's a little boring. 2019 was also unexciting and boring, and foreclosures are down 28% from 2019, the last normal market year we had. That's a pretty good news. That's good news for the market, right? Foreclosure filings in 2023 were down 88% from the peak of 2.9 million in 2010. We had 16 million foreclosures between 2007 and 2016. We're in great shape on this front right now, folks. So if you look at that, that is a really good indication of where the health of the market is. Now, here is another slide that is kind of mind-boggling. In the face of half the inventory we need to have a normal inventory market, in the face of rising prices of homes, even in the face of rising interest rates, one in four people in this country believe that home prices will decline in 2024. That means 25% of the market is waiting on the sidelines thinking they're going to get a better deal next year because they think prices will go down. Let's answer that question. This is what people want, is they want facts. And some people get upset at the facts, but here they are. I can't defy this logic. This is the normal behavior from the National Association. Now, I'm not a big fan of the National Association of Realtors in some ways, but they do put out some good data in certain aspects, and this is one of those areas where they do good work. 49-year average monthly price movement from 1973 to the year 2022. This is how the market behaved. This is just giving you a snapshot. When do prices really go up? I've always said it's kind of a stair step. Right, so in January, it's pretty tepid. By April, May, June, July, prices shoot through the roof. That's why the best time to buy is between November and January, not when everybody else does it, because you have to pay more, prices go higher. And if there is price depreciation in a year that's up a little bit, it's normally during November, December, January, and February. So this is how prices behave. It goes up nearly a point every May, year over year. Up nearly a point in April, up close to a point in June. So you get about, what, 6% appreciation every year, year over year, for the last 50 years. Yet one in four people still think this is going to happen this year. So here's the numbers from last year. Arguably one of the most trying and challenging years in real estate in, I don't know, 15 years, since 2008. Last year was probably the most difficult year of real estate since 2008, even if you're a successful broker doing a lot of business. So I went one step ahead. Let's go back. Price movement 2023. So overlaid here, I'm going to use my mouse here to show you. This is the graph I just showed you about one point in April, May, June, and July. This is what actually happened in 2023. So we had a little bit of a dip when rates started really taking a hit in early 2023 in January. Prices across the country went down about half a point. We saw roughly that in Charleston. And in November, prices went down, dipped just a little bit. So again, I go back to, when's the best time to buy a house? It's get ready now. Of course, prices will be higher in November than they are right now. So the best time to buy a house in a rising market is as soon as you're ready. But if you are in October and you decide you need to buy a house, that's the time to do it. Is November, December, and January. As prices go up a lot more. Every month last year, according to the trend, except four, I think it is, outperformed the 49-year average based on the 2023 price movement. In the worst market, we faced in terms of dynamics since the Great Recession crash. So this is what we had by both major indices, the Case-Shiller Index, which measures the top 20 markets, and the FHFA, which is the Federal Housing Administration, Federal Housing Finance Administration, I think. I may be getting that wrong. But basically, we had a solid year in the face of very challenging headwinds. So home values went up. Now, here's the big story. If you want to really predict housing and what's going to happen over the next 6 to 12 months, the graph that I'm about to show you is that one. But before I pop this up on the screen, I just want to say the real indicator of the next 2 years of housing is jobs. Jobs are strong. We're adding jobs. There's no weakening of jobs. So this graph should take hold for the next 1 to 2 years because there's no indication that we're going to see a spike in inventory. It may go up some, but right now, if you look at 2010, the top of that graph, there was nearly 12 and a half months of inventory. And then today, we have about two and a half to three months of inventory. It is an extreme seller's market, only beaten by a couple of years ago when we had roughly a month and a half of inventory. So we have to get out of the green into the neutral to start seeing prices wobble. And right now, the trend, if you'll notice, the last measurement period, which was, I think, January, February, the trend was it was moving back downward. It's going to continue to do that through the spring, even though interest rates have spiked up some. So one final graph here, equity numbers. This is a very solid indicator, too, of the health underlining or underpinning the real estate market. So the reality of this is that Americans are sitting on tremendous equity. 67% have paid off their mortgage or have at least 50% equity. So the average home in the country, $400,000 or $500,000. The average person either has no mortgage to a couple $250,000 in equity. That is as healthy as we've seen the equity numbers in real estate in a lifetime. 38.7% of people own their home free and clear. And that number roughly mirrors the transactions in the market. So as we see rates creep up and everybody goes, oh my gosh, right? So nearly 40%, more than a third, of the entire market are cash buyers. They don't care what the rates are. They don't have a mortgage to consider. So you've only got about one-third, the estimate is exactly one-third, of all homes have less than 50% equity. So this means that when you look at the interest rates being 7%, and I'm going to wait on the sideline because prices are going to come down and rates are going to come down, and the latter might be true. The former, I don't think so, not in the next year or two. You're actually losing ground. The gap is getting bigger and bigger because more than a third of the market doesn't care about interest rates, and nearly a third of the market has more than 50% equity. So their payment isn't going to go up exponentially if they sell their home, walk away with $200,000 or $300,000 in equity, and put that down on the next house. Their payment is going to go up a little, but not a tremendous amount. It's the people in the bottom third who have just bought their home, have a high interest rate, don't have as much equity, but that equity is growing because they're in the ownership game. What this graph shows you is that you should be in ownership if you're not already. And if you're not ready, that's okay. You just need to get ready. You can go to my website at crabtreemortgage.com and reach out with me. We'll get you ready, whether it's 2 months, 2 years, to be in the game of home ownership. The inventory problem continues. Supply and demand economics continues to drive this up. This was as of a month ago. There was a lot less inventory, historically low, 40% lower than the last normal market of 2019. Let that sink in. We have, like, on a nationwide level, like hundreds of thousands of homes too few, not listed. Like, we need a million listings right now. We need a deluge of listings, not from bad economic situation, but half a million listings would just slow down the appreciation. It wouldn't cause depreciation. In the Charleston Tri-County area, if you look at this marketplace, we have about half of the listings that we had this time in 2019, just shy of half. It mirrors this graph. So most of these national numbers I'm giving you are illustrating what's going on here. And now we have the home price forecasts, the part you may have been waiting for, because everyone wants to know, how's my equity? So if you want to check your individual equity, you can go to my website at lowcountryequity.com. That's going to take you to the little search bar with the address tool. You're going to put your address in there, and then you're going to be able to forecast your equity. From that, I'm probably going to follow up with you and say, hey, listen, these automated equity calculators are pretty good. They're getting a lot better, but I'm going to give you a much better equity calculation, and that's going to be free and at no charge on a one-sheeter just like this, and you'll be able to see where you stand. The consensus of home price forecast for this year, the median, is Fannie Mae. I'm not saying that they're accurate, but Fannie Mae is saying about 3.2% appreciation, even in a year with super high rates compared to what they were 2 years ago. They're saying we're going to have good appreciation. Goldman Sachs is pretty bullish. They say 5%. And in a market like Charleston, if Goldman Sachs is right, that's a double-digit appreciation for the Charleston market. If Fannie Mae's right, we're talking 6 to 8%, even in a year where things are arguably just a bit slow. So here's another chart that shows a different view of the predictions. The average of all eight of these, adding Realtor.com, who thinks we're going to go see almost 2% decline in housing this year, 2.7%. That's pretty good. The average house, that means you're going to gain, without doing anything, you're going to gain, what is that, $10,000, $12,000 in equity. You know, that somewhat covers your interest. So that gives you a leg up, gets you a step ahead, upward mobility in housing ownership versus renting, because the interest rate on renting is 100%. So if the rates are going to be high and the payment's going to be high, but the prices are going to keep going up, and that's what the forecasts look like for at least the next year or two, you're going to gain ground by buying and not waiting. So one last slide just to remind you. One in four people still believe prices will depreciate this year. Just not likely to happen. Now, finally today, we're going to cover mortgage rates. So you're thinking about getting a better mortgage rate. So here's what we got. Rates below 6%. That seems to be the number everybody's talking about. So here's what Doug Duncan, Senior VP and Chief Economist of Fannie Mae, says. We anticipate that after the past several years of extreme volatility in interest rates, the 30-year fixed-rate mortgage will continue to moderate over the course of 2024. Now, as I record this video, it's been moderating up. So it's been a rough week last week. So the rates are now in the low sevens. But the rates will dip back down again, most likely. We had a little bit of an inflation scare. But it was just sort of part of, it's kind of like this. It, you know, nothing goes in a straight line up or down. It's going to do like this, but the trend is going to be basically like that, moving toward below 6% by year end. If we get below 6% by year end, prices continue to go at the clip we expect, we will be back in the game of lowering inventory and multiple offers. Finally, the chart that gives you rate predictions from Fannie Mae and kind of is agreed with us, some of the other predictors of mortgage bonds and such, that by the fourth quarter of 2024, the rate will bottom out at about 5.8. So that's about 5.75. That's a savings of about 1.5% of where they are now. And here's the good news for people who buy in that timing. You need to be getting ready now, getting your credit as high as possible, getting all of your ducks in a row financially. Go to crabtreemortgage.com and we'll work on that there. Or you can go to housedog.com if you want to look at the real estate side of things. But you're going to want to be in line, have a strong approval, have the best interest rate available. Points will be lower. So you'll actually maybe be able, as rates are declining through the 6% threshold, you might actually pick up an interest rate at 5.75 at some point late this year, maybe, and actually get $1,000 or $2,000 back from the mortgage company like the one I work for, because if rates go down, they'll be incentivizing you to get a mortgage, whereas right now you've got to pay some points in some cases to get that mortgage when rates are up in the 7 range, because there's a risk they go higher and then these lenders get stuck with these higher lower rates in a higher rate market. That's starting to settle out some. But as we go through 6% rates in quarter three, we're going to see a pretty vigorous, I think, August, September, October. And then if it goes down below 6, the clip will, it'll be a pretty interesting, if this times out the way they're predicting, which may or may not happen, 50-50 shot, we'll see a very brisk fourth quarter in housing, and we'll be faced with likely too little inventory still. So in the meantime, if you want a personal home equity checkup, which will be to the penny what you could walk away from at closing most likely in today's market, just go to lowcountryequity.com. That's just a subdomain to my main website, housedog.com. If you want to get pre-qualified for a mortgage, I'm the one getting the email. I'm the one that's going to help you with that. Get that set up and get you off to the mortgage company, crabtreemortgage.com. Again, that's just a subdomain of Crown Home Mortgage. My NMLS ID is 180-9223. But just reach out to me whatever way you best wish, and I will help you in your low country of South Carolina housing needs or anywhere across the country. I'll put you with an agent that thinks smart and works hard for your best interest. Housedog.com, and you have a great week.